subject.
Guys, welcome to Clement. Today we shall be looking at Introduction to Physiology. So as part of the things we shall be looking at, we will look at basic terminologies in physiology, excitability and properties of excitable tissues, and irritability. So by definition, physiology is from the two Greek words, physis and logos. Physis is nature and logos means the study of something. So physiology is the science which studies biological functions and mechanisms of a whole healthy organism and how it adapts to a new environment. So this is how physiology is differentiated from pathophysiology. So physiology studies the mechanism of a whole healthy organism, and pathophysiology studies pathological states of an organism. Yeah. And then one very important thing is that how the body adapts to a new environment as part of physiology. So as part of the structure of physiology, if you are a student, you want to be a good student in physiology, your anatomy, histology and biochemistry should be very, very good. So these are the foundations of physiology: anatomy, histology and then biochemistry. So by definition, so this is histology actually. By definition, cells, we say, are the basic units of life which makes up tissues and organs. And by the cell theory, we say that a cell can only come from another cell. Tissues are a group of cells. So we have muscle, connective tissues, and epithelial tissues. And then organs, an example of an organ is your brain, the heart, and then the lungs. So they are a group of specialized tissues that perform a specific function. So your brain, the function of your brain is different from the function of your heart. So they are specialized to perform a specific function. Glands. So organs in the body that secrete particular substances for use in the body for discharge or for discharge into the surroundings. So these glands are actually organs, and they are epithelial tissues. There are two types of glands. We have the exocrine glands and then the endocrine glands. The difference is that the exocrine glands, they have ducts and they secrete their content outside of the body. Example is a sweat gland, salivary gland, and the mammary gland. And then the endocrine glands, they don't have ducts, but then they release their contents. Most of them release hormones into the blood. So what is a system? A group of organs and tissues that perform the same function is a system. So we have the respiratory system, the nervous system, immune system, skeletal system, and all that. They are a group of organs and tissues that come together to perform the same function. So what is a function? In physiology, when we say function, we are talking about specific activity or specialized structures. So the activity that the specialized structures do is their function. The next terminology is regulation. It is a complex process which ensures the adjustment of organs and systems functional activity to different environmental conditions. So we will see the difference between regulation and homeostasis. Homeostasis is a relative constancy of internal environment and stability of main physiological functions, which are ensured by totality of physiological regulatory mechanism. So the difference is that homeostasis is a constancy of internal environment, and regulation is a process that ensures this homeostasis we are talking about. What is mechanism? Mechanism simply means a way of doing something. So the way the body is able to regulate its function is called mechanism. Okay, so let's look at negative feedback. So negative feedback is a fundamental mechanism that keeps a variable close to its set point. So this is a process in which the organism detects changes of any parameter and activates mechanisms that negate or reverses it. So we can talk about so many things, like the buffer system of your body. When there is a change in the acidity or alkalinity of your stomach or your blood, the body has a mechanism of reversing this buffer. We are not going to go into buffer systems now. And also in temperature regulation, when your body is cold, when you step out in the cold, your body is able to detect the cold and your muscles shiver to generate heat. Another way is also for your hypothalamus to also signal your pituitary gland to send some hormones to your thyroid gland, and then your thyroid gland is able to release some T3, T4s, which also is able to regulate your temperature. So that is negative feedback. It all helps in homeostasis. Okay, so let's talk about something that is very, very important: excitability and irritability. So every living tissue can exist in two states. It's either you are in a state of rest or activity. What it means is that it's either you are doing something or you are resting. But this rest is not a pathological rest, or it is not an absolute rest, because when you are resting, when you are asleep and your muscles are at rest, there is still metabolism in your body. So your body is not in the total rest, as we're saying. But then this is a physiological rest. So let's quickly look at excitability. People sometimes they get confused. What is the difference between excitation and excitability? So we shall quickly look at that. So excitability is a property of most differentiated cells to respond by specific adaptive reaction under the influence of special stimulus. So it is a property. So let's look at excitation. So excitation is the specific state of excitable tissue, but then excitability is a property of differentiated cells. So some cells have the ability to respond to excitation. When we have these cells like that, we say that they have the property of excitability. And we shall look at some of the properties of excitability. So manifestation of excitability is an indication of a state of excitation. So what it means is that when a cell or a tissue is in a state of excitability, we see that there is excitation taking place in that tissue or cell. I hope you understand. So when your nerve fibers receive excitation, which is also the same as action potential, when they are excited, they give impulse. So before you can contract your muscles, your nerve must send electrical impulses so that these electrical impulses will be converted to mechanical impulses so that you can contract your muscles. And when your muscle fibers also receive these impulses from the nerves, they contract, as I said. So another one is secretory cells, like we said in glandular secretions. When these glands receive excitation, they release their hormones. Or if it is sweat gland, they release their sweat and everything. They release their content after excitation. So these are the properties of excitable tissues. The first one is contractility. Contractility. And when we talk about contractility, what comes to mind is muscles, skeletal muscles. They have the ability to contract. Then we have excitability. Excitability, like glands. Salivary glands, yeah, they have the ability to be excited and then they release their content. And then we have conductility. What comes to mind is your neurons. They receive conductility. They're able to conduct electrical impulses and then they send it to wherever it has to go. And the last one is automaticity. So what comes to mind? Cardiac muscles. So your heart muscles have this special function. That is why you don't control your heartbeat. Your heart is able to beat by itself because it has this automaticity. So let's look at some of the tissues. Now we are going a little into histology. Let's look at these tissues. So we have about five different tissues over here. The first one, you see these nerve tissues, you see the cell body, you see some dendrites and some axons over here. So this is a nerve tissue. When you see this, you can't miss it. Specifically, it's a nerve tissue. These are glandular tissues, and you see how it's arranged. And these are muscular tissues. This is skeletal muscle, your cardiac muscle, and smooth muscle. You can look at the difference. When you see a smooth muscle, you realize that, yeah, it's quite different from the rest of the tissues. Okay, so as we have looked at excitability, let's look at irritability. So it's a property of all biological systems to respond by non-specific misdirected adaptive reaction under the influence of different stimuli. So when there is a manifestation of irritability, it is called irritation. There is a thin difference between irritation and excitation. Sometimes they are used interchangeably though. Okay, so let's look at irritants. The irritant of a cell or even the whole body is any change of internal or external environment which can be perceived by the cell and which can cause the response reaction. So to cause a response reaction, the irritant must meet some requirements. The first one is that it must have the threshold strength. What it means is that there is, in some of my subsequent videos, we shall look at how the cell membranes are able to go through excitation. So there is a sub-threshold and there is a threshold limit that the irritant must meet before there can be action potential. So this threshold strength is the minimum, it's not the maximum, but the minimum strength which is able to cause a response reaction. The second point is that the threshold irritant must act during a definite time. So time is also very, very, very important. It is called the utilization time. The third one is that there is steepness. So there is steepness that this irritant must meet. If the strength of the irritant increases from sub-threshold to threshold too slowly, the cell has time to adapt. So if that is why you feel that you touch someone or you try to call someone by touch and the person doesn't feel it, the first thing is that the threshold, you cannot stimulate or initiate action potential because it is sub-threshold, or the steepness is not there. Okay, so let's go through the classification of these irritants. We classify them based on their nature and physiological significance. So based on the physiological significance, we have adequate irritants and inadequate irritants. And according to their nature, we have physical, physical, chemical, and then chemical. So the adequate one is specific irritant for which perception, the tissue is evolutionarily adapted. I will explain over here. So you see that this particular one, what comes to mind when you see this? The eyes, because we are looking at photons of light and we are looking at the cones and then the rods over here. So this is the retina. So the eyes, as they are adapted to light, you see, they are adapted to a specific range of light, and the sound, the ears are also adapted to a particular sound. So you call someone, the person does not hear you. That means that the irritant is not adequate. You understand? It's not adequate. That's why human beings cannot see in the dark, because our eyes are not adapted to see in the dark, but then we are adapted to see in the light. So that is adequate irritant. Inadequate is irritant that acts on the tissue which is not adapted to it. So through evolution, I'm speaking science now, so through evolution, it's believed that our bodies have adapted in so many ways. So our eyes are adapted to the photons of light and our ears are adapted to sound waves. So according to the nature, we have physical irritants. Examples are temperature, electrical, light, and mechanical. When we say mechanical, we're talking about pressure. pressure, putting pressure on someone. So when something hits your leg, that is what we are calling mechanical. And then physical chemical, we are talking about pH, osmotic pressure, and then colloid state. And then chemical, we are looking at poisons, hormones, acids, drugs, etc. So this is the introduction, the first video for introduction to physiology. So we are not going to talk about so many things, but then we are going to look at this question. I specifically brought this question so that you know that some of the terminologies we spoke about are used in the field of medicine and especially in the classroom. So, quiz of the day: an isolated cell of human heart automatically generates. So over here we see automaticity. It automatically generates excitation impulses. So we see another word here, excitation, with a frequency of 60 times per minute. What structure does this belong to? So I'll be expecting your answers. You can hit me up, you can comment and then give me your answer, and then we shall discuss it. Thank you very much, and make sure you like, you subscribe, and you share it to your friends. The public.